James Van Praagh is a remarkable medium. He has the ability to connect with the spirit world and receive messages from deceased loved ones. It's a powerful, powerful experience. Or James Van Praagh is a fraud who, like the rest of his ilk, preys on grieving people in order to make money from them. Or James Van Praagh likes to help people as a therapist, but he knows damn well he can't really communicate with dead people. It's a clever charade. So these are some options to keep in mind as you watch this video of my session with James Van Praagh. Now, whether or not James and other mediums can do this, communicate with the dead, is ultimately not a matter of opinion. This is something that can be proven or disproven. Very simple. Can he come up with specific information that only the deceased person and I would know? If he does, he's proven himself. If he doesn't, and only comes up with good guesses and generalizations, then he's disproven himself. And if he fails, we can reasonably discount all the other mediums because James is at the top of his field, and if we disprove the best, we can dismiss the rest. For my session with him, I tried to suspend my disbelief as best I could and to just go along with the program. I know that if I had questioned him at every instance as we went, the session wouldn't last more than 5 minutes before he'd call it quits. So I played the role of a large congenial marshmallow in order to let the whole thing play out and gather the evidence, which would disprove or prove his alleged ability. I would say the most prominent specific technique is what I call time shifting. The medium fishes for information from you by asking questions. He gets something confirmed to you either verbally or by your facial expression, and then he immediately pretends that he had just gotten that information from the dead person before asking you the question. For example, the medium will say, "Did your father smoke?" You'll say, "Yes," and he says, "Because I see a man smoking here. The man here is smoking. He's smoking." So he's consistently trying to establish this illusion that he got the information from the dead person first, but he didn't. He got it from you after you gave him the answer to his question. So this time-shifting technique is very, very common with every medium that I've encountered. All right, let's see how he does.
I think you're very, very sensitive, and I think you have an ability to connect with the spirit world. I really do. So let me just tell you what I pick up. First of all, there is definitely a yearning within you in your energy field of helping people. So you would have been born, your soul would have been born with the desire of, I need to help other people. I need to be with people and help people. I know that when you were a young child, you would not have been understood very well. You've been a bit of a loner in some ways as well. And I know that you would have been also into books or reading as well. And I know I would have lost myself in books. I would have lost myself in another world with books, and I would have been taken away. And I would have found myself in that world would have been more real to me than the human world. You understand that, don't you? Like your imagination would have been a good imagination.
Yeah. Although yeah. I like to think I'm realistic.
Well, you are, but I like your imagination. I think you have a good imagination, too.
As a kid, I liked books. I liked to read, but I was much more sports-oriented, not book-oriented. In fact, to this day, I'd rather go out and shoot baskets than read a book.
Do you have an older sister?
No.
Do you have a younger sister?
I had a younger sister, yeah.
You had, and she's passed on.
Yeah.
I get her right next to you on this side of you, this over here, your right side.
Aha, the time-shifting technique. James immediately pretends to see my sister a split second after he finds out from me that my sister is deceased.
because I have a sister here, and she's very connected with you, so she definitely wants to come in and speak with you, okay? So we'll get to her in a second, but I just want to continue working with you. Who's Edward or Ed? Do you know that name, living or dead, Edward?
Edward. Boy, I...
So let me ask you about the eyes. I'm just going down the eyes here. I don't know if you recently had an eye checkup or there's been a problem with an eye.
I had, yeah.
Yeah, and so I want to tell you that I feel that there might be something still not finished yet with your eyes. Might be something that's coming up again or not finished yet. Are you aware of that?
Well, I do have an annual eye checkup.
Okay, so there's something coming up with you're putting eye drops in your eyes. So I see that. You're pretty clean. You're pretty clear, though. You're pretty clear energy. God, I keep on hearing Mickey in my head. Mickey. Did Father call you Mickey? Your mother call you Mickey?
Mickey.
Okay, hold slowly. They're very pushy. Hold on. Mickey will be in a second. I know. He wants to talk to you. I know. I understand that. Your father's pushing. And that's creativity. So that's a lot of creativity. Now, you had to have wanted to write books or have written books.
Yeah.
Okay, because you have to, because it's there. That's creativity for you. That's right there. You have that ability. You have that gift with words. It's there. Expression is there.
This is an example of a possible hot reading. I'm sure it's very easy for James to have looked up my name on Google and found out that I've written a few books.
You also could have been a painter or artist when you were younger.
Well, I didn't think James was right about my artistic ability at first, but the more I thought about it, maybe he's right. I remember a picture I drew when I was 6 years old of the Lone Ranger on top of Silver. And as I remember, the picture was pretty sophisticated for a six-year-old. The colors I chose, the details, it was very realistic. You could recognize Silver right away. So I wish I had... Wait a minute. I do have that picture. Let's take a look at that picture. Yeah, right. I could have been an artist. Yeah, right.
Not really, because I was not very good at it. I remember the third grade, the kid drew this terrific picture of a maple tree, and I thought it was so good, and I tried to do one myself, and it was nothing compared to his. And I realized I can't draw.
I like colors around you. I like beautiful colors. Down here, the digestion area is a little slow down here. It's a little bit problematic down here, okay? So I feel like I need to get a little movement down digestive area. Things are a little slow here. So whether that means getting a little more exercise or eating right or drinking a lot more water and getting movement going on there, you need to. Okay? Sorry. And it's also emotional stuff, which is down in the third chakra. This chakra here is your solar plexus. And it's a lot of emotional stuff holding on to. There's a lot of emotional stuff, too.
I do not have constipation. I don't have stomach problems. I eat pretty well. I exercise regularly, so James is wrong about that. I don't have emotional problems. There is one major unresolved issue in my life, but James didn't come within 100 miles of guessing what that is.
Into the solar plexus area, there's a lot of feelings here that I feel a little bit of guilt, and I want to resolve that because I feel like you're holding on to some guilt. And I need for you to let that one go because you don't need to hold on to it. It's not yours, okay? We're going to get to it.
Okay.
You know that I'm on to it, right? You know that I'm right?
I think.
You know that I'm picking up on the guilt, right? Yeah. So there's that situation. There's a little bit of feeling of, I want to also talk about forgiveness. And I want to talk about you need to forgive yourself because I feel like, you keep on saying, I should have done this, I could have done this, I could have done this, and you couldn't have, okay? So they want...
Contrary to Van Praagh's claim, I am remarkably free of guilt. I'm pretty much at one with myself. I do not go against my own moral compass, so I don't experience problems with guilt. I experience the normal problems everybody else does, stress and goals and annoyances and so forth, but they're not centered on guilt. Here comes another technique. The medium will say, he's going to tell you something, But he proceeds not to tell you something, but to ask you something. And yet you get the impression that he told you something. He actually asked you, and you told him, and then he pretended that he told you. See how it works?
And I got to tell you, were you married?
No.
You're not married.
I was not actually married, no.
And so the average client remembers this exchange as the medium miraculously coming up with information, when what actually happened was he simply asked you, you gave it to him, and then he pretended that he got it.
So I know that your mama is coming in strong. Your mother's here, and she's. I don't know, when you were a young boy, did she ever have to point her finger sometimes like this at you when she was a, you know, wanted to get a point across?
No.
Because she's like this to me. She's like, listen, you listen, and she's like very strong. You gotta listen.
That's not my mother. She didn't have to make an effort to get my attention. I know that's a common dynamic in many families, but it wasn't in ours.
So let me just work on that. Okay, so let me just first tune into your mother. Can I just work on her?
Okay, right.
Yeah. Got her. Okay, thank you. Okay. Got it. That's it. That's great. I'm going to tell you with your mother when she comes in here. She must have had either two sisters on the other side of life. Are there two sisters over there, or are there more?
Jeez. No. She had a brother.
Oh, she has a brother over there.
Yeah.
I think there's a sister over there. So I know your sister is over there. But there's also one of her on her level as well.
No, my mother did not have a sister.
And I want to ask you, was she raised by another woman? Was she raised by not her mother? She was raised by somebody else? Was she raised by a grandmother or an aunt or something?
She was raised by her grandparents.
Grandparents, thank you. Yeah. But she's spending time with them over there, too. Uh-huh. Just to tell you that. Go ahead. I understand. But...
A good hit? No. Again, the value of a transcript. I didn't realize at the time that I had accidentally said her grandparents, and I meant to say my grandparents. In other words, my mother was not raised by her grandparents. She was raised by her own parents, my grandparents. But James took what I said and ran with it. So this proves that he's reading not dead people but me, because he ran with what I accidentally said.
And I'm going to ask you who the name, it sounds with an R, initial R in the name, an R.
In my immediate family?
Yeah.
R. You mean beginning with R?
Yeah, just straight. Let me like get more information from them. I'm not sure. Your mother's talking to me. Hold on. When your mother speaks to me, as she comes close to me, she's like, said, will you please listen to me? And you make sure you listen. And she's very much like, you have to listen to her. She takes my head and she pushes my head to her, that I listen to her. And when she's speaking, you be quiet and you don't talk when she's speaking. You understand that? And I know when we're having dinner at the dinner table, you be quiet until you're spoken to. And this is the way she comes in. It's very much the manners, you know. When they come through, they come back to memories of when they were here. And when she comes through, it's all a matter of, you know, be polite and mannered. And she's talking to me about this.
The technique, switching topics quickly, if the current one's not getting anywhere. James was getting nowhere with the R name, so he switches to my mother. And as he switches to my mother, he continues building on the erroneous assumption he made earlier that my mother was a strict, traditional, old-school mother. She wasn't. She was very down-to-earth and kind of liberal.
And she, I feel, when she comes in here, she talks about her childhood. And I do feel she had a very tough childhood in her own way. I feel she had a hard childhood. I don't feel her father was there at all for her, okay? So I don't feel she either knew her father or there was a connection with her dad at all. I got to tell you that.
James is continuing to build on his previous error that my mother was brought up by her grandparents and therefore, logically, her own father was not around. But he was.
And I don't know who Lucille or Lucilia or Lucina or Luciana or something this name is.
Connected to my mother?
Yeah.
Can't think
of it. But you'll have it on the tape, so you can play it later, maybe it'll help you, okay? So that's how this works. Sometimes they give you a name you don't know at the moment, but later you listen to it, oh my God, that's the bad person.
Does that make any sense? That dead people anxious to talk to us will bring up the names of tangential people, people we have to struggle to remember, instead of people we immediately recognize? That doesn't make any sense. What makes sense is he's playing a guessing game and making wrong guesses.
And the R would be either a Ruth, like a Ruth, that would be the R person, okay? Ruth. And I also know Rose, so Rose. Now, I don't know if it's Rose is the name or she's Candy or Rose, but I'm getting Rose from your mother.
James's string of bad luck continues. There is no Rose or Ruth in my life, or my mother's life, that's significant. There's no connection between a Rose and my mother and me.
Now, go on. She worked, I think your mother worked very, very hard. She showed me her hands, and she worked very, very hard. I think when she was a young girl, she also worked at, did she used to clean people's houses?
No. Oh, wait a minute, let me think.
She was 17 years old.
Not that I remember.
I think she had to do chores when she was a young girl and clean houses or clean, I think she did. When she was 17, 18 years old, I think she had to work for she had to work chores.
Yeah.
You don't know this.
I guess.
Actually, my mother's family was fairly wealthy before the war. They even had a maid and a summer residence, so I doubt very much she went around as a teenager cleaning other people's houses. This is James trying to do a warm reading, saying what is true of many people of that era, during hard times, lots tough jobs, manual labor, whatever. But my mother's family was distinctly upper class. They weren't working class.
Yeah, I understand that. And I want to tell you that she's showing me, or giving me the information here, that I'm listening to classical music. I'm listening to classical music.
Note the technique here. Once he gets confirmation from me, you can clearly see me nodding my head as though I'm confirming it, then he pushes it harder. That's what they do. They read, and then the reading of the client determines for them what direction they go in.
And this is a very big deal, and she's just giving me this. Okay, I got to give this to you. So I don't know if you had to listen to that when you were a young boy, or she gave you this music, or she had albums of hers, like when, you know, we go back in time here.
Albums, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
But she's mentioning that to me. And she likes to listen to that. And I like the ballet, so she likes the ballet. She's showing me ballet here, so she talked about the ballet, okay?
Good guess, but my mother never spoke of liking the ballet. Reading was more important to her than music or dance. And why is it, James, that you don't come up with tennis? Because that was a big part of my mother's life when she was young.
And did she pass over first, before your father?
No.
Oh, after your dad?
Yeah.
Was it not much time, though? Was it like 3 years or 2 years?
Between the two passings?
Yeah. Yeah.
There was time. There was.
Oh, was there? Hmm. How long is it? I don't know why I'm getting 2 years, 3 years here.
It's about, let's say, my father was 79, my mother 98. So it was a good
year. Big difference.
Yeah.
Here's another technique, spreading the net wider if you don't catch any fish at first. Here, he's trying to make a hit, figuring that maybe my mother and father died within a few years, as is frequently the case, but that's not the case. They died many years apart. So now he's going ahead, spreading the net wider and fishing for anybody that died in the last 2 years.
Why is they telling me 2 years has passed? Something 2 years ago. Right?
From my mother's death?
Who died 2 years ago? Why is it
something? Who died 2 years ago?
Who was just 2 years ago?
My brother was just a few years ago.
Notice that I deliberately said a few years instead of 2 years. A few years, hoping to give James some rope with which he could hang himself, and he immediately proceeds to do exactly that.
Okay. So 2 years ago. Okay, got it. I understand. Got it. Thank you. Got it.
Right. My brother died in 2007. 2013 minus 2007 equals 2. No, it equals 6. I am starting to get an inkling that maybe James Van Praagh is not reading the dead, and maybe, just maybe, he's playing a guessing game.
Yes. And is there a burial plot?
Yeah, a place, yeah.
The next technique, the medium misses, but from the response of the client, figures out a way to spin the response in such a way so that he ends up getting a hit instead of a miss.
Is there a photograph on somewhere on that? Is there?
No.
No,
but I thought that would be a nice idea if I could do that someday.
You did think of that, didn't you?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Because she's telling me that about a photograph at the burial plot, and there was a thought about a photograph at the burial plot of your mother or the family, and you did think about that. Okay, got it. Thank you very much.
No, you didn't get it. You missed it. Thank you not very much.
I understand that. Right. Now, I don't know about this, but she's very particular about things, your mother. You know, very particular about having things in the right place and in the right order. and this is what she's on about.
About the burial plot?
About everything in life.
Everything, huh?
Yeah, but I know even about the burial plot, or where it is, she'd be very concerned about that. You know that.
Because it's...
Like, picked it out. Mom has to like this, or she wouldn't like this, this sort of thing. Now, was there a mausoleum, or was there a wall at one time?
No.
Just the ground?
Yeah.
I understand that. Okay. I understand that. She's very funny. I'm trying to get a concept of what she's talking about. You know, it's not like, hi, how are you today? It's like a concept of a thought. And with the concept, so I want to explain how the process works. So the concept she's giving me is like, I'm crossing into a building, and then I'm looking out and I'm seeing graves. But I have to go near a building first, and then I'm seeing graves. So when she's with you, when you visit or go there, you must have to go by some kind of a building, and then you go see her.
Yeah.
Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Yeah, your explanation makes sense to me, but why my mother would communicate that to me makes no sense. If my mother communicated that she was very glad she was able to reconcile with my brother before she died, that would make sense. But to say to me, I have to go past the building before I go into a graveyard is totally pointless. That is useless information. And you'll find mediums do that a lot. They give you a ton of useless, insignificant information, proving they're just playing a guessing game. They're not reading dead people.
I understand that. So she's with your father, but I have to tell you that she has to make things right. So she had to make things right before he comes over. She had to make things right.
Aha! Caught James with another telling blooper. He claims that my mother had to get things ready before my father crossed over. James forgot that my father died 20 years before my mother died, so she would never say she's got to get things ready before he crosses over. Big mistake.
Can I just go back a little bit?
What
would my mother want me to do with the grave arrangement or whatever, other than keep it clean?
No, you did a great job. You did a great job. You did a great job. What she was trying to come back at was her personality is someone whose everything has to be a certain way. You understand? She likes things a certain way. You did fine. But, you know, with her, her personality is black is black and white is white and corners are corners and, you know, this has to be this way.
She wanted me to move the arrangement of the... I mean, I got my... There's my mother, father, sister, and brother there.
Right. You did fine. You did great. Right. You did a perfect job. And actually, you maintain it beautifully.
No, I don't. The cemetery staff does. There is a distinct, less than ideal feature to the arrangement of our family gravestones. Two of the graves are separated from the two other graves by a row of graves because there wasn't any room. So that's something significant. Problematical to a person who allegedly is very picky, and yet somehow my mother doesn't say anything about that. Here comes the time-shifting technique again, getting some information from me and immediately pretending you got it from the dead person.
And was there someone that took piano lessons?
When I was young, very young, yeah.
Yeah, because you're talking about the piano lessons. You remember taking the piano lessons. Yeah. There was definitely a connection between your mom and your dad as far as height-wise, too.
What the heck does that mean?
You know, height. Wasn't there?
Like
was
it
a bit taller than she was? Wasn't
well, tall.
She?
Well, you mean a difference in the...
Yeah. Was he about a foot taller?
Not a foot. Half a foot.
Half a foot. I also want to ask you...
What was the point of that? Dead people are so eager to talk to us, and what they want to tell us is their relative heights, something I already know. That's totally pointless. And notice that James said a bit said tight, then he said a bit taller, then he said a foot taller. So he tried to cover all bases. That's another technique, covering all bases. So that went nowhere, so he quickly switches subjects.
I also want to ask you, when they originally came over at one time, was there a boat ride or ship that they came over on?
Yeah.
And wouldn't you know about the ship ride or heard about tales of that ship that they came over on? Would you have a photograph of that ship? Wouldn't you have a photograph?
Do I have a photograph of the ship? No, I don't.
of them on that ship, or of the ship, or you wouldn't have anything to do with that then. Okay.
James makes a wrong assumption here, that my parents came over and then I was born here in this country. But I was not. I was born in Europe. We came over when I was 4 years old. I was on that trip. I remember it very well.
I know that your mom's told me about, she rode over on the ship, or they came over on a ship. And so I don't know what this is going on about, but just bring me back to when she's coming over to the U.S. Did they go through New York?
Yeah.
James is right, but I don't want to give him too much credit for that, because during that time period in history, most immigrants landed at Ellis Island in New York.
So what did she say about the trip over?
She didn't like it. She did not like it. And I think she was sick to her stomach.
No, I would have remembered that. The salient factor on our trip was not rough seas or seasickness, but cold. We were allowed one blanket per person, and it was cold. Also, we had another problem, ongoing family problem. The captain confiscated our pet monkey because his allergy papers weren't in order.
Now, whose birthday is in July?
In my family?
Yeah.
Nobody in July.
Again, the technique of casting your net wider when you miss on your original guess.
Or what happened in July? There's something in July that's significant, like a passing or an anniversary.
And none of them were born in July. None of them died in July.
Okay, we'll keep July because something's coming in July. Significance. I don't know what that means. Make things right. Now, who passed with a cancerous condition? Cancer. Was it your sister cancer?
Yeah, my sister.
Okay. Because I'm getting a cancerous condition. At one point, was there breast cancer with her?
Yeah.
Because that's what she's going on about.
Okay. That's a hit. Doesn't prove anything, but that's a good hit. I mentioned another person and that had died, and he guessed correctly that it was also of cancer, so he had another hit there. He went on to describe various things that my sister went through, lost weight, had trouble eating, hated the medicine, et cetera, the normal things that a breast cancer victim goes through, as James knows. So that's another technique the medium uses, making just some good logical general deductions from the initial information that was given.
I think that she must have been in some kind of a coma before she passed over. I'm like this, and I'm totally out of it. Yeah. And I feel like, to tell you, I don't know if someone has a rosary, or they put a rosary near her, or they said prayers with her. Did you understand that? And I don't know if I want to give her the last rites, but I know about this whole thing. She's aware of this. She's aware of some bit of rosary there. I don't know if it was you that did that, but I'm very, very aware of that.
Monkeys will fly out of my butt before my sister or I have anything to do with the rosary. My sister decided very early on that traditional religion was not for her.
I'm very aware also that, believe it or not, there's a nun who comes to see her from the spirit world. And this is very interesting. But there is a nun who comes to greet her from the spirit world. That's very interesting. So I don't know if your sister knew a nun or there's a family friend who was a nun, but there was a nun.
No, my sister did not know any nun. There was no nun that was a friend of the family. And the place where my sister died, a hospice, was not Catholic. I never, ever saw a nun in that place.
Then I must say to you, you kids must have gone to a Catholic school when you were younger.
Yeah.
Because I asked her, who was this nun? She goes, oh, she was when we went to Catholic school. So this is a nun that she must have grown up with in a Catholic school, because there's a nun that comes to get her and tell her not to be afraid.
James is running rampant with wrong assumptions here. After I told him I came from a Catholic family background, I hoped he would make all kinds of conventional assumptions about what one normally expects from a Catholic family, and he did that. But as it happens, it doesn't really apply to our family. The fact is, my father was not religious. My mother was Catholic originally, but then later on in life had nothing but contempt for the church. My brother strongly rejected Catholicism. My sister rejected Catholicism. My sister, I think she went to Catholic school 1 year in grade school. And my brother and I very early on went for a couple of years, but we were released after 2 years for good behavior and time served.
I know there must have been some kind of a mass that was a funeral mass for her, wasn't there? And she talked about that.
No, no mass, no thought of a mass. We had a nice remembrance party. My sister wanted to be remembered for her good qualities and to have her life celebrated rather than her death mourned.
I know that there's a Catherine, Kathleen, Kathy, something with that name, Kathy, Catherine.
Of her friends?
Alive, not dead, on this side. It's a Kathy, Catherine, Cassie, Kathy. The one that brought her wig shopping, she wants to thank her. So she can't get through her name, but she said, my friend brought me wig shopping, and I want to thank her.
Isn't that odd? My sister can't remember the name of her best friend.
And did your sister have a children at all?
No.
No, never had a child. Did she always want one?
Not especially.
Was there anyone named Angela?
Boy, all these names you're coming up with, I'm drawing blanks.
Right, so you have it recorded, so listen to it later, and then maybe it'll come in. And go on. Yeah, in a second. And did you put lotion on her back or have lotion on her?
No.
And who's Joseph? Or Joe?
Again, I don't have a Joseph in my family or a close friend or anything.
So just again.
At the time of the session, I thought Van Praagh was doing poorly. But when I checked my transcript, I realized he wasn't doing poorly, he was doing exceptionally poorly. Now, New Age believers who believe in this stuff have a standard all-purpose defense. They'll say, oh, well, of course it's not going to work for you. You're a skeptic. Your energy is all wrong. You have to be open for it to work. But they can't use that defense here because Van Praagh very clearly said, my energy was quite clean, that each of my people were right there next to him, and that they were coming in very strong, very strong. So believers can't claim that my attitude was undermining the process because Van Praagh clearly expressed that the process was working for over an hour. He didn't stop after 5 minutes and say, oh, I'm not getting anybody or I'm feeling kind of weak today. Nor can believers use the excuse that, well, some mediums are not that good and that I need to find a qualified medium, because Van Praagh is universally acknowledged to be at the top of his field. And they can't claim I can't expect 100% correct reading. No, who's talking 100%? Just give me 50%, please. Otherwise, Van Praagh is no better than the fortune teller at the beach. Which reminds me, I did that once. I went to a fortune teller at the beach. I think it was $10 for 15 minutes. And she told me real garden variety, general kind of stuff. But, and I'll never forget this, there was one thing she told about me, one insight, and to this day, I don't know how she knew this about me. I don't know how she knew it. She said to me, Mickey, you don't like to be bossed around. I don't know how she knew that. I cannot figure out how she knew that about me.
Now, remember before I had Rose, again, I talked about Rose, I'm giving you roses from your sister. And I'm going to give you those roses from your sister because she's giving them back to you. So you must have brought roses to your sister's grave, or you must have brought roses to her at the hospital, or roses, because she's talking about roses.
No, I never brought roses to my sister or to her grave.
And I need to give you a statue of an angel. So she's giving you a statue of an angel, and I don't know if that's symbolic, but she's just giving that to you so you know that it's from her. Here it is.
No, that's not my sister. If my sister wanted to identify herself to me from the dead, she would probably be wearing the Elvis sunglasses with the sideburns attached, which we found so funny every time she wore it. That's how she would communicate with me. But Van Praagh just continues to parade a bunch of conventional ideas that apply to many people, but not as it happens to people in my family. At this point, the session is becoming, I would say, supernatural, because only the supernatural would explain James's bad luck. It's that bad.
Here's the big...
Wait, you have to cross... Why is she talking about something about crossing over a bridge Was there someone who was afraid of a story about crossing over a bridge, or someone who was afraid to cross over a bridge, or would you have to cross over a bridge to get to a house or something? Some kind of a bridge? And some story he's going about a bridge. Is he a mother's house, or was there a...
There are no significant bridges in my life.
A bridge.
That I can think of.
When you were kids, was there some kind of a trestle or a bridge you had to walk over?
No.
All right. I'm sorry. I don't know what she's on about. Yeah.
Why didn't you tell me about how my sister was scared as we climbed the Leaning Tower of Pisa? The thing is leaning and you're standing near the edge. It was pretty scary. That was a significant experience we had together. And it was something that only she and I and not you would know. But you couldn't come up with that, could you?
But I want to ask this important question about my sister.
Yep. Okay.
We did have one serious disagreement. And like we play tennis, and every once in a while we'd play tournaments together, and we one day had a serious disagreement there. I don't know if she knows, can understand my position better now, or I don't know if she has anything to say about that.
What? You barely remember it? She barely remembers it.
Really? Jeez.
We didn't talk for a while, she said.
After we disagreed about it, yeah.
We didn't talk for a while, she said.
Right.
I understand. She understands. She was wrong, but she was stubborn.
Okay. She's admitting.
She's stubborn, she said. Yeah. You must have been right, but she didn't want to admit it. Is that right?
I think that's what I think.
Well, she said you were right, but she didn't want to admit it.
She wouldn't listen to my explanation, and I was so mad that I didn't even want to give her the explanation as to what happened and why.
She said you were right, but she didn't want to admit it.
James made some good generalizations, but he had no clue as to what actually happened. And he was off the mark in saying it was insignificant, something barely worth remembering. That was not the case. This is what happened. This is where the Andover Tennis Club used to play on these 7 courts here. I was playing on court number 5, and the club policy was, if there's people waiting, like over here, then after an hour you should relinquish your court. Now I knew, what my sister did not know, she was one of the people waiting here, that these two courts had gotten on significantly before we had gotten on. So they should have given up their courts before we did. And after the hour, I wanted to yell down to them, these two courts are available. But I couldn't do that because you can't yell across 4 courts and disrupt play like that, or walk across and disrupt play. So I just figured, well, these people ought to be more assertive and ask for the court, or these people should do the right thing and relinquish the court. And I couldn't handle the situation from where I am here, 5 courts over, so I continued to play for a while longer. And then later that evening, my sister, with a very sharp edge, accused me of hogging the tennis court. She didn't know those 2 courts had gotten on before us. So that was the argument. The point is that Van Praagh completely mischaracterizes it as something my sister wouldn't remember. Fairness is very important to my sister and to me.
Now, why does your brother go quickly?
Heart attack.
He's with her right now. Right now he's here. And he comes. He went quickly. He goes quickly. He said, I went quickly, just like that. And he said, I came in quick and I went quick. And he goes, my whole life's quick.
Actually, I don't know for sure if he went quickly or not. He didn't show up for work after a weekend, and people got worried, and we went over to his apartment and we found him dead there. So I don't know if he went quickly or not.
And he goes like that. His whole life goes da 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 da. And he's fast. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you know? He's quick. He's quick. He doesn't have time for grass to grow under his feet. He just goes. But I do. Didn't he like music?
Yeah.
He like music. I like music with him. I like music around him.
That's odd. When I cleaned out his apartment, I didn't come across any tapes or cassettes. Not one. There were hundreds and hundreds of books. Yeah, here's another technique you should be aware of, not applicable to James, because he was identifying each person individually before he told me about them. But often when they do like a group session, they will use several people at the same time, so it gives them a wider latitude of getting a hit. And they'll say, oh, no, I don't mean her. I meant her over there standing right next to her. Or no, not this person, it was the other person. So that gives them a better chance of getting a hit. That's a major technique they use, which, as I say, is not applicable here, because in each case here, James identified each of my people very specifically before he talked about them.
And did he live in different places, by the way?
Several different places, yeah.
Because it's funny, before we were talking about, no grass grows under my feet. And it's almost like I feel like, you know, like going here and then going there. And it's like, I can't, you know, like I'm not committing myself to one place. I'm going to experience this over here. I'm not committing myself to one place.
The big mistake that James is making is to interpret my nods as nods of agreement. Yes, he's right. When I'm just agreeing, yes, I understand what he's saying. I hear what he's saying. So he's running off in wrong directions all the time. And this one with my brother is funny. James said, I'm not committing myself to one place. That's my brother speaking. I don't think so, Mr. Van Praagh. My brother lived in the same place for the last 40 years of his life. In fact, this is amusing. He had gotten this apartment in the back of this lady's house for the price of $50 a month. $50 a month. So he wasn't going to move. It was a great deal for him. In fact, one winter, his heat went out, and he went like half the winter without heat before he talked to the lady about it, because he didn't want her to suddenly realize, ooh, she's not charging him enough. You know, he just paid her every month and didn't see her and wanted to keep it that way. So James was wrong about my brother. At this point, I mean, this is getting comical, all the misses that James is making.
Yeah, and the name C-A-R-O is Carol. C-A, I think it's either C-A-R... O-L-E or K-A-R-O-L-E comes in. So I don't know what that means. It's in the spirit world, not living on the other side. And did he have a drinking situation with him at all?
No.
He didn't?
No, that was not one of his things.
Yes, let me get your dad. Let me bring your dad in. Let me bring your dad in. Yeah, because he's right here. I got it. Right. Did he own a company?
No.
Here comes the time-shifting technique again.
Did he have a briefcase?
Yeah.
He just shows himself walking with a briefcase. Yeah. I'm going to work, he said. Good. Did he have a brother that also passed over?
Yeah.
I know that about more than one.
No, my father had only one brother.
There's one significant one that he's close with, or is closer with.
He was close to him, yeah.
And that they've met up again, and I got to tell you that they've really connected again, and I must tell you that. The family had polio in that family, but there was someone who was stricken with polio.
I never heard of any instance of polio in my immediate family or my extended family.
And I want to ask you, before your dad passes over, did he have some words with you? Wasn't he very strong? And was there any upset before your dad passes?
No.
But you know, I got to tell you, with your father, I don't know why I feel my mind is gone, but I feel like I'm losing my mind. Okay. So I don't know if he has slow dementia or something, mental capacity going on, but it feels like he's telling me he lost his capacity of his mind.
No, my father did not have dementia. He died at age 59 of an aortic aneurysm.
He does not care an iota about you not being there. It didn't matter to him. He understands it. He understands. He knows your heart was there.
That was a good response, and he went on to talk about how many people prefer not to have anyone around when they die. That's an interesting insight. But what medium is going to say to you, Mickey, your father is still very angry at you, and he thinks you should shoot yourself immediately, if not sooner? They're not going to say anything negative.
And I want to ask, does anyone in the family ever fly in the war, or fly planes, or an Air Force of some kind?
Air Force, no.
No? Did he ever want to be in aviation, your dad, ever?
Never told me that. What comes to mind is my grandfather was in the military, and he wanted me to be in the military.
Flying planes?
No, not flying planes.
My grandfather once did show me how to make a paper airplane, but I'm inclined not to count that as a hit. Okay, now I'm going to tell James and Praagh a lie. I'm an honest person, and so normally I make a bad liar. But if the situation, the context, the motivation is right, I can be a good liar. Like if the Nazis come up to my door and say, are you hiding any Jews? I'll say, hell no, I'll be a good liar. Same here. I'm going to tell them a lie that my father was in a drunk driving accident when that's not true. And we'll see what he does with that. If he comes back with information that my father is saying, what are you talking about? I was never in a drunk driving accident. Then we'll know he's talking to my father. But if he comes back with information that, oh, he's ashamed of that incident and so forth, then we'll know he's not reading my father, he's reading me.
Does he know the degree to which I was disappointed that he was in a drunk driving accident once? Because, you know, he normally didn't drink, but there was this one situation, nobody got hurt or anything, but I never told him how disappointed I was to know that this had happened.
That was maybe the drinking thing I was picking up before too, remember? Yeah, let's see.
I mean, he didn't drink around me much.
He keeps still going on about how I wish you could understand things differently, a little differently. So knowing things differently about him and the dynamic with him and your mother and the dynamic of him at work and the dynamic of him having a family. So there's a whole thing which I don't know if you're even aware of he's going on about. So I think there might have been some stresses and some pressures there that...
That made him drink a little?
That made him drink a little bit. And he's, yeah, and he keeps on going on about how he was very sorry it hurt you. Sorry it hurt you. And he knows he embarrassed you on several occasions.
My father never embarrassed me. Never. There was one time, even one time when he honked a horn to get the car in front of us to move out into the intersection, otherwise we were never going to get out. And the guy got out of his car and started yelling at my father. The way he handled that was with grace, and I was proud of him. My father never embarrassed me.
Because normally he was...
He's ashamed of that. He's ashamed.
Okay. Yeah.
He's sorry. He's ashamed of that. And please don't think of him that way, he said.
James Van Praagh, you're full of shit.
Can I ask one? Is there something very specific that would tell me, like, what my father's nickname was for my mother, or something that I would know for sure? It's
oh, only if they brought it through. Only if they brought it through.
Yeah. Because I'm not entirely convinced this whole thing works.
So you have to read more on it, on the mediumship, and see how it works, you know, how they came through. And listen back to the tape and see what has come through and different things, and evidential information.
Okay, but I'd really like to have some sort of, you know, I would like a proof of the afterlife. If I have like a list of 20 things that if any of these deceased people could say, they would prove it to me, because only I and them would know it. Like my father's, what my father did after he showered all the time. What my father's nickname was for my mother.
Right. Right. I can only give it if they give me it. I can't make it. I can't pull things out of thin air. I can't do that. But the personalities, that's what you really want to concentrate. You can't concentrate on one little thing because it's much more than that.
Yeah, but I'm trying to establish afterlife.
Right.
And it
right.
can only be established by a very specific thing that only I and that person would know. For example, like what my father used to do for hours in the countryside when he was young. If you just say what that is, then I would know, oh, that's him.
Right. But if I'm not giving it, if he's not giving it to me, I can't make it up.
Well, why would he want to give it to you? I mean, that would show it's him.
I know. I just can't make it up. He's not going to present it. It's not like, hi, how are you doing today? It doesn't work like that. They're not on the same level that, hello, we are here. hello, how are you today? It doesn't work like that. So it's more of a feeling. It's more of an impression. It's like, right now I'm thinking of something. I want you to say what I'm thinking of.
What you're thinking?
Yeah, tell me what I'm thinking of right now.
What do I think you're thinking? You're thinking about you have another appointment coming up.
No. No, that's not what I'm thinking. Why can't you get what I'm thinking? Why can't you?
I don't claim to be able to read minds. You claim to be able to read, to read dead people.
If the spirit does not project an image a certain way, and you know, a certain way that the medium can pick up on it, it's like it's very much like frequency. It's like a radio station.
The intention of the deceased person is they're clamoring to get in touch with me. They should say right off the bat, "Oh, this is me. This is the nickname my father used to,
Well, that's what we'd like them to say, but that's not what we would like them to say that, but they didn't. I mean, they don't. But the sister came through and died of cancer. The other one had cancer, or certain names came through, or a certain situation.
Well, if she came through with the name of her best friend, that would do it.
If she did, I wish she would have. But I don't know how many names that they came through with. I don't know.
Well, you came through a lot of names, and none of them matched up.
Oh, I know, Mickey. I gotta have to go over the tape again. All right.
Yeah. Well, I
gotta go because I've spent a lot of time. All right.
I know, but I have to say, I this didn't work. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. Okay. Bye.
Bye.
Here's a short clip of Van Praagh talking about what he does as a medium, what he can do. It's on a program called Afterlife TV with Bob Olson.
A medium brings through evidential details, names, places, events, situations, memories that only the person from spirit and the person receiving the message would know about. The mediumship reading then would be, hello, I have your father here. His name is Max. He tells me that he died in 1978, and he used to drive an Impala, brown Impala station wagon, and he has a memory of you in the back seat with a beach ball. And he's watching over work with you, and he's there behind you, and you have a picture of him in the desk on the left side. That's a mediumship reading.
Now, that is exactly what would prove that he is indeed receiving messages from the deceased. But that is exactly what he does not do. He just claims that's what he does. It's a bald-faced lie. When it's time to come up with the goods, he does not and cannot do so. He did say to me, I have your father here, but he did not say his name is Gasper. He died in 1979. He used to drive a white Buick. He has a memory of me making a nice play at third base, and I have a picture of him on top of the bookcase at the right. That he did not say. Let's tally up Van Praagh's hits and misses and see how he did. He had 12 hits, the best of which was that my sister had breast cancer. Others, like my father, had a briefcase. Pretty lame. Misses. How many misses did he have? 64. That is an 84% failure rate. 84% failure rate from a man considered by many to be the best in his field. And the most telling statistic, the number of things he told me that only the dead person and I could know, zero. Zero. Exactly as I expected. Zero. Exactly as I knew would happen. Zero. It's so easy, James. My father's nickname for my mother. My mother's favorite comedian. The name of my brother's cat. What actor my uncle looked like. A whole bunch of specific things like that, which in my particular case would prove your alleged ability. You came up with not one of them. Nor did you come up with any general information that was of any significance to me. Now, I found Van Praagh to be a pretty congenial guy. I'm sure he's got some good qualities as a human being. But I find it very offensive the way he dismisses his archenemies, Michael Shermer and James Randi, two men who know what they're talking about. As a person who cares about the truth, I find his whole charade very offensive. There's something profoundly immoral about promoting a belief system that is provably false. Taking a sacred subject, the memories of our deceased loved ones, and making a guessing game and a business out of it. YouTube has some excellent material on mediumship. There's Michael Shermer debunks James Van Praagh and psychics. There's James Randi, homeopathy, quackery, and fraud. That was very good. Penn and Teller, talking to the dead. These people know what they're talking about. A final important note. I think my session with Van Praagh disproves the spirit world, as he calls it, as he presents it. But, and this might be a shocker or a disappointment to you atheists out there, I am a theist. I do believe in God, not the Christian God or traditional God, but a more credible version of God. I do think an ultimate spiritual context of the world makes more sense than the universe just being here by accident. And so, if one believes in a God and in an afterlife, and that humans are ultimately spiritual beings who continue to exist in some other different dimension after death, as I believe, I think it makes sense that deceased loved ones do receive our thoughts. I do not say we cannot communicate with the dead. I say only that we can't get them to communicate back in any literal, tangible way. We can disprove literal communication from there to here, as I like to think I just did, but we can't disprove communication from here to there. God, if he exists, he might not exist. Maybe the atheists are right. I don't know. If God exists, he does not allow such unequivocal proof of his existence or the existence of an afterlife. We theists have to go on faith that our thoughts and emotions and memories of our deceased loved ones will somehow be validated ultimately and not just turned to nothing. I do believe that ultimate reality is spiritual, not physical. You can check out my website, confrontingbelievers.com, for more material on these issues, particularly a CD called Great Debates Distilled. It's on whether ultimate reality is spiritual or physical. And a DVD called Credible Atheism versus Credible Theism, where I sit down with a leading atheist, Dan Barker, and discuss the existence of God. Thank you for watching, and good luck to you in your own spiritual journeys.